Good morning and welcome to your new day. And we do have breaking campaign news, in some ways a new day on the campaign trail. The former Vice President Joe Biden is going to deliver a speech that goes right after President Trump. It's a primetime speech, and we were just given a full copy. Ask yourself why the Biden campaign is releasing this 12 hours before he's delivering it, because they want the president to know. The vice president, former VP, will be delivering this speech at the same time the president will be addressing a Republican dinner in Iowa. Biden plans to call the president an existential threat to America. The former vice president seeming to try to egg on the president, who you can bet will respond.
Biden also plans to hit Trump over the trade war that has affected farmers in that state. He says, in part, how many sleepless nights do you think Trump has had over what he's doing to America's farmers? Here's the answer. Just as many as he had when he stiffed the construction workers and electricians and plumbers who built his hotels and casinos. Zero, end quote. Both men will be crisscrossing the first in the nation state all day. So joining us now to talk about all of this, we have Bianca Rodriguez, a CNN contributor, Jeffrey Toobin, CNN chief legal analyst and staff writer at The New Yorker, and CNN's John Avlon. Okay, let's read a little bit more of this hot off the presses speech that we have. Here is, I think, Joe Biden's main message. He says, quote, our democracy is at risk. I never thought I would say those words, but it's true. Everywhere you turn, Trump is tearing down the guardrails of democracy. It's the abuse of power. And if there's one thing I can't stand, it's the abuse of power. Quote, fake news, quote, enemy of the people. These aren't words to be laughed at or dismissed. John Avlon, you are the speechwriter among us.
A former speechwriter, recovering. It is fascinating to read this speech, though, through a speechwriter and political lens. It is a populist attack at the president from the left. He's trying to remove his credibility on the economy, saying a cashier at Target has understands the economy better than President Trump. He's going at him saying, you know, if he was just another rich guy in a gold-plated apartment in Manhattan, tweeting it wouldn't matter, but he's the president of the United States. He's trying to clean up that China gaffe he made a few weeks ago. The significant section of the speech is about how he takes China's global competition seriously. And he's dressing Midwest floods and other things folks in the Midwest have been suffering with for weeks and weeks, and saying it's about climate change and saying that Donald Trump is denialist and we need to choose science over fiction.
You make a good case there that the former VP is trying to say Trump is a detached rich guy, which is an argument a lot of Democrats wished had been made in 2016.
Yeah.
That was not really the thrust of the Hillary Clinton campaign.
Well, it's harder for Hillary Clinton to have made that argument.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
And Joe Biden has been riding the train.
Middle class Joe as his political persona, as a contrast to Trump.
But there are people who worked on the Hillary Clinton campaign who think that was a drop ball, not doing that. Mm-hmm. There's another message that I think here is very interesting, Bianca. It's that the important thing here is Donald Trump. The important thing here is the big picture, not what you heard from these 19 others in five-minute speeches last night here in Iowa. It seems the vice president is trying to move this discussion beyond the primary in a big way.
We'd already passed the primary, and we have the two candidates here. Look, it reminds me a lot of the Mitt Romney speech in 2016, calling the president phony and listing all of the things that he didn't fulfill or all of the things that he's talked about in his life that actually were not true. It seems in many respects you have Joe Biden calling out the president on China, saying, yes, we should be tough with China, but you're not doing it in the right way. Talking about the economy overall, you're not handling the economy correctly. You don't understand the economy, and you don't understand the plight of many of Americans who are suffering in large part because of your policies. One thing we don't see him focusing on right now or any of his Democratic other running mates and opponents.
What's interesting also is that in the speech he says that Biden says he didn't plan to be in Iowa the same day as Donald Trump, because that had been speculated,
right,
that he is already positioning himself as having won the primary. And so he wants Donald Trump to be his competitor, but that it was just by happenstance. But of course, he's clearly making hay of it.
He is indeed. And you know, what I keep thinking about looking ahead to the fall election is the only way there are two ways the Democrats can win. They can switch Trump voters back to the Democrats, or they can increase turnout among their base. Biden's trying to do both here, but I think it is more designed, especially in Iowa, a state that the president won pretty handily.
9%.
Right. And a state that Obama won twice, you know, a big switch, to try to persuade them that they've been suckered by this guy. Now, the president is going to say 3.2% unemployment, What's wrong with that? Why do you want to turn back from that? That's not going to be an easy argument to refute. That's what he's trying to do, but that is not.
And Biden's going to say, where did that 3.2% start from? Where did it originate from? And
He uses the Obama administration
and the recovery that the Obama administration had made for years before from the greatest financial crisis since the Great Depression.
Yeah, I mean, the meager jobs numbers from last month could help Joe Biden's case if he says that, you know, things are starting to, because of the tariff threat, et cetera, things are starting to shift.
He's going to say, look at what we're seeing replicate itself. Look at every single failure in this president's life. He'd been handed everything, going back to even his own father. He talked about that before, inheriting $200 million, which he'd squandered. And as he's saying, he's doing the same thing with the economy, which our administration had handed
him. And his kickoff point is directed at farmers in particular, saying America's farmers are being hurt by this trade war. They're being hurt by tariffs. And there's a case he can really make in that. And look at where he's giving this. Not only, you know, Iowa, obviously, but these pivot counties that are going to be so key. We're going to be talking about, and we should be talking about in the coming weeks so much, because there are 206 counties in the country, largely in the Midwest, in the upper Midwest, that Obama and Biden won twice and Trump flipped in 2016. Any Democrat to win, you got to flip a large portion of those counties back.
Biano, you're bringing up President Obama. Let me just read you where Joe Biden, it's not even, you know, it's in the first page. He doesn't wait to drop the Obama bomb here. One of my proudest moments in the White House was when President Obama and I led the rescue of the American auto industry. We knew what it meant to the millions of jobs in the auto companies and the supply chain. So, you know, it's very overt what he's doing in terms of the economy and the former president.
Well, and look, this can be dangerous to some degree because you don't want to continue to ride the Obama coattails and not present anything new. But to his credit, he was a huge player in the sense that Obama knew that he is a man that had relationships on both sides of the aisle throughout the Obama administration. So anytime any policy was in jeopardy, who was it that came in to try to save the day, to bring both sides together? It was Joe Biden. So he's saying we're not seeing that from this administration. In many respects, people are criticizing him on the left, at times complimenting or saying we need to work with the right. He's listing an example of when that actually worked.
That's a point in the speech that I think a lot of the Democratic base will rebel against. This idea that the Republicans will come to their senses, that Mitch McConnell, though he doesn't name Mitch McConnell, will work with me. I think the Democrats think the Republican Party is irredeemable at this point, and any suggestion of collaboration is not a positive.
So he's no question he's getting a lot of heat from the base, from the activist base. But if you look at CNN's polling of the top three attributes that people, Democrats, say they're looking for in a candidate, number three is an ability to work with Republicans across the aisle. So it may be another case where that activist progressive base, it doesn't necessarily reflect the rank and file.
And if you are dealing in the real world, as sometimes we like to do, it is extremely likely that even if a Democrat is elected president, there's going to be a Republican Senate.
Yes.
So the idea that you can somehow pretend the Republican Party doesn't exist as a Democratic president is just, you know,
that's
crazy.
Exactly.
And yet it will not be a cakewalk for Joe Biden in Iowa. A couple of points to point out. This is only his second visit to Iowa. The governor of Montana, Steve Bullock, has been there a dozen times. Okay, so he is...
Where is he in the Iowa polling right now?
Well, I mean, you make a good point.
He's ahead of John Delaney, who's been there even more.
Yeah.
And Google John Delaney if you don't know who I'm talking about.
Yeah. And he was the first to announce he was running after Trump won.
You make good points. Joe Biden is obviously still coasting on his experience and his name recognition, but Iowans may not take lightly to the fact that this is only his second appearance. Second... nowhere in this speech does it mention his flip-flop on the Hyde Amendment. And so...